Greeting and welcome to our virtual service for this weekend. We're so glad that you joined by this means. And also thank you very much to those who send texts or Facebook message or in other ways encourage and remind that these are useful and helpful for you and that you are inviting friends to listen in and tune in as well. We just want it to be a blessing. And it hopefully won't be too much more longer that we'll be able to be together physically, but for now, we thank God for this opportunity that we have to be together in this virtual service. Pastor Larry, would you lead us in a word of prayer and then our time of worship?
Father, we praise you because you are God. We praise you, Father, because you love us. We praise you, Father, that even though we can't meet together in a corporate setting, you meet with us where two or three are gathered together. Regardless of the setting of the home, the church building, you're with us. And so, Father, we praise you. We thank you. We know that you are in control. We know, Father God, that you love us and that you're not caught off guard. And, Father, that's the most important thing that we can thank you for. This whole thing is not something that caught you by surprise. Your Holy Spirit is with us. And so we give you praise. We thank you now as we worship you. Be with us. And just glorify your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Come into his presence with thanksgiving in your heart. Presence.
Text or an email telling me which one of these is your favorite. Number one, life does not come with a manual, but it comes with a mother. Number two, as we get older, we don't just feel appreciation for mother, but admiration. Number three, mother, thank you for raising me back in the day before moms could post embarrassing pictures of their kids on Facebook and Instagram. Number four, you're the main reason I turned out so awesome. Number five, mom, I get it now. We can't get through Mother's Day without mentioning Proverbs 31. A godly woman is precious. Her children rise up and call her blessed. Well, today we're going to talk about the church as soldiers. So we're going to be on a theme this week. On Saturday, the 16th, it's Armed Forces Day. So I guess we are on theme with what's happening culturally. We've talked about the church, the temple of God, the family of God. The church is the city of God. The church is the bride of Christ. Today, soldiers, the church as soldiers. Now, typically, in a series or a theme like this, a minister might title this, The Church, the Army of God. And that's not wrong at all. In fact, that's quite biblical. However, that term, the Army of God, has been co-opted and distorted and misused by certain radical groups. And we're not going to suggest any validity for any extremist anti-government groups. That's not what God's church is about. Amen. So we're saying what the Word of God says about the church as soldiers. Our text is in 2 Timothy chapter 2, the first four verses. You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus. And the things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also. You therefore must endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. We thank you, Lord, that we are indeed a mighty army of believers doing the work of God. We pray, God, that you will cause us to endure as good soldiers so that we can be pleasing to the one who has enlisted us into the good spiritual fight of the good things that you want us to be engaged in. Lord, we thank you for the discipline. We thank you for the instruction. We thank you for the camaraderie that we have as people who belong to you as soldiers of Jesus Christ. We pray, God, that this word would be strong and powerful in our hearts, that we'll receive it, and we'll live it in Jesus' name. Amen. In the Bible, God is called Lord of Hosts, or God of the Angel Armies, 278 times. Yes, somebody counted. Exodus 15, verse 3, it says, the Lord is a warrior. Zephaniah 3:17 says, the Lord your God is in your midst, a victorious warrior. In our hymn books, we have a song, Onward Christian Soldiers, Marching As to War. Books and sermons have been presented on the theme of spiritual warfare and how it's properly understood and how it's properly applied as believers. A pastor, Gordon Cook, said Jesus rarely employed military imagery, and there might be a very simple reason for that. Remember how militaristic the Jews around him were at that time. They were expecting a political Messiah, a military Messiah, a Messiah who would come with a sword. They wanted a Messiah who would wipe out the Romans and set up a political kingdom like David. They wanted a man of war. Well, it's true of Jesus, but Jesus was not an anti-Roman government activist or an armed mercenary rebel. He fought a different kind of warfare. He taught a different kind of warfare. It's beyond psyops. It's spiritual warfare. And he fights for us. Aren't you glad for that? He is leading us on, and he's showing the way. Matthew 5, verses 38 through 40. You have heard it said, eye for an eye and tooth for a tooth. But I tell you, do not resist an evil person. If anyone slaps you on the right cheek, turn to them the other cheek also. If anyone wants to sue you and take your shirt, hand over your coat as well. That's the kind of military attitude we're to have. Very submissive, giving, and very much that we rise above everything that comes against us so that we can represent a higher calling and a higher spiritual warfare and not be drawn down to lower levels. When somebody tries to bring you down to their level, rise up and respond from Christ's kind of response. And he is humble and he is gracious, and through that we win spiritually as soldiers of the cross. Luke chapter 22, verses 36 and 37. When Jesus sent them out on another journey, he said to them, "But now he who has a money bag, let him take it, and likewise a knapsack. And he who has no sword, let him sell his garment and buy one. For I say to you, that this which is written must still be accomplished in me. And he was numbered with the transgressors. For the things concerning me have an end." So they said, "Look, Lord, here are two swords." And he said to them, "It is enough." So the majestic statement that Jesus made about his calling, and this is coming to its fulfillment, and be aware, and by the way, you might need a sword. And, oh, swords, he's talking about sword. Ooh, let's get a sword. I like how it says it in the Message. They said to him, "Look, Master, two swords." But he said, "Enough of that, no more sword talk." Matthew 26, verses 50 through 53, when they were in the garden on that night before the trial and the crucifixion. Verse 50, "They came and laid hands on Jesus and took him. And suddenly one of those who were with Jesus stretched out his hand and drew his sword, struck the servant of the high priest and cut off his ear." Now Peter wasn't aiming for his ear. We know this man's name was Malchus from another gospel. Peter had a sword. He was ready to fight for Jesus. He was ready to get it on. Let's bring the war. And he thrust or he swung, and Malchus had quick reflexes, and he ducked or dodged. He got his face out of the way. He got his neck out of the way. But Peter was ready to take action. But Jesus, verse 52, said to him, "Put your sword in its place." That's a powerful statement, isn't it? Put it in its place. "For all who take the sword will perish by the sword. Or do you think that I cannot now pray to my Father and he will provide me with more than 12 legions of angels?" And what did Jesus do? He healed that man's ear. Jesus' spiritual battle was far superior to Peter's presumed concept that this is now the time for a physical battle. We are soldiers of Jesus Christ. We fight to win. We fight to win within. That's the first spiritual battle, is within ourselves. We go to James chapter 4, the first 12 verses. Very important portion of Scripture. "Where do wars and fights come from among you? Do they not come from your desires for pleasure that war in your members? You lust and do not have. You murder and covet and cannot obtain. You fight and war, yet you do not have because you do not ask. You ask and do not receive because you ask amiss, that you may spend it on your pleasures. Adulterers and adulteresses, do you not know that friendship with the world is enmity with God? Whoever therefore wants to be a friend of the world makes himself an enemy of God. Or do you think that the Scripture says in vain, the Spirit dwells in us, the Spirit who dwells in us yearns jealously, but he gives more grace. Therefore he says, resist the proud. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Therefore submit to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you." There's our fight. "Draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Cleanse your hands, you sinners. Purify your hearts, you double-minded. Lament and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to gloom. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he will lift you up. Do not speak evil of one another, brethren. He who speaks evil of a brother and judges his brother speaks evil of the law and judges the law. But if you judge the law, you are not a doer of the law, but a judge. There is one lawgiver who is able to save and to destroy. Who are you to judge another?" This passage tells us straightforward, if we don't fight to control our inner passions through the power of the Holy Spirit, we will wind up fighting one another. We will wind up fighting for our personal rights. We will wind up challenging and misjudging one another. So we must begin by fighting that spiritual battle with ourselves, our own nature, our own desires, our own selfish plans, and our own will. We must submit, realize that we are soldiers of the cross, and we are enlisted in something that's higher than ourselves, and we need to have that total loyalty to our commander, Jesus Christ. And if we can, by the power of the Holy Spirit, if we can win that spiritual battle within ourselves, then we can be in camaraderie with other believers and dwell in unity. 1 Corinthians 9, verses 26 and 27. The apostle says, therefore I run thus, not with uncertainty, thus I fight, not as one who beats the air, but I discipline my body and bring it into subjection, lest when I have preached to others, I myself should become disqualified. There's a popular modern Christian song that says, this is how I fight my battles. This is how I fight my battles on the spiritual level. I discipline myself. I realize that I belong to God through the power of the Holy Spirit. My own agenda, my own desires. You know what? Being disciplined is part of being a disciple. Living a disciplined life, disciplined heart, disciplined mind. Disciplined, as the apostle here says, I discipline my body. I don't let myself just get carried away by my desires. I check myself and say, does this please God? Is this honoring to God? Is this the way God wants me to live? Colossians chapter 3, verses 5 through 10. A lot of scripture today, but it helps build this understanding of who we are as soldiers of the cross. Colossians 3, verses 5 through 10. Put to death, therefore, what is earthly in you. Sexual immorality, impurity, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. On account of these things, the wrath of God is coming. In these two you also walked when you were living in them. But now you must put them all away. Anger, wrath, malice, slander, and obscene talk from your mouth. Do not lie to one another, seeing that you have put off the old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge and after the image of its creator. That's the spiritual battle, is allowing the Holy Spirit to make us like the Lord. That's the work he's doing. And so don't fight God off. Fight alongside of the Lord, and you'll have success. James chapter 3 has a lot to say about taming the tongue, that none of us can tame that tongue. So many things can be tamed, but taming the tongue is such a fierce battle, and we can only do so by the power of the Holy Spirit. We need to speak words that are good and kind and gracious. Colossians 4:6 says, let your conversation be always full of grace, seasoned with salt, so that you may know how to answer everyone. That's always something to pray about on a daily basis. Lord, make my words, my conversation, my speech, the things that I have to say, the things that I have to share with others, may it always be full of grace. May the grace of Christ shine through the things that I say. It says seasoned with salt. It's a reference relating to the ancient salt covenant of sacrifice. I have sacrificed my right to lose my cool with anybody. I've sacrificed my right to try to put down somebody who doesn't have the same political understandings that I have. I've sacrificed my right to, if I have a different opinion with somebody about social matters, cultural matters, or who's supposed to take care of the bush between my property and the neighbor's property, I sacrifice my right to push my agenda. I need to be seasoned with salt. I need to understand that I have a covenant with God, that he owns my words, he owns my conversation, and it must be always, according to this scripture, always full of grace. We fight supernatural battles. We fight in supernatural battlefields. 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verses 3 through 5. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war according to the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty in God for pulling down strongholds, casting down arguments, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Our enemy is the devil. Our enemy is not other people, even those who have allowed themselves to be used by the devil. Other people are not the enemy. The devil's kingdom is our enemy. We keep that in mind. There are many, many verses of scripture that we won't deal with today that remind us that we are to be strong, encourage us to be courageous and valiant in battle spiritually. Many, many scriptures, some of which you perhaps have memorized, and they're good for our edification and strengthening. We have Christ's authority as we live under his authority. If we do it his way, according to his commands over our life, we have authority over the supernatural realm. So we don't have a carnal war underway, but we have a powerful spiritual warfare underway. We're pulling down strongholds. You are mighty. You can pull down strongholds if you do so under the guidance and authority of the Lord our Jesus Christ. The way it says that in the NIV there in 2 Corinthians 10, though we live in the world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not weapons of the world. On the contrary, they have divine power to demolish strongholds. We demolish arguments and every pretension that sets itself up against the knowledge of God, And we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. The New Living Translation says that very same three verses this way. We are human, but we don't wage war as humans do. We use God's mighty weapons, not worldly weapons, to knock down the strongholds of human reasoning and to destroy false arguments. We destroy every proud obstacle that keeps people from knowing God. We capture their rebellious thoughts and teach them to obey Christ. That's the battlefield, and that's the win. That's the successful campaign when people come to the knowledge of God through Jesus Christ. And we're able, as the Spirit of God speaks through us and works through us and lives through us, that we can draw people to the knowledge of God and they become obedient to Christ. That's the win in our spiritual warfare. An English scientist and Bible teacher named Mike Taylor said, "The church is here for a reason to fight a war. It's a war that only the church can fight. Charities and corporations and governments cannot do it because only we have the spiritual weaponry that's needed. There's a lot of compassion in this world, a lot of desire to get certain things done to help countries, to help societies, to help individuals, and a lot of good can be done. A lot of charities will raise money and send medicine and send food thousands of miles away to bless somebody's body, but not reach their soul. Only the church can reach the soul. So we thank God for all the good things that are being done around the world to help those near and far, especially in these crisis times of this pandemic. A lot of people are doing heroic things to help people physically, but only the church of Jesus Christ has the final resource for the help they need, and that's for their spiritual life. That's for their spiritual heart. We fight in high praise and worship. 2 Chronicles 20, verse 21, King Jehoshaphat appointed men to sing to the Lord and to praise Him for the splendor of His holiness as they went out at the head of the army, saying, "Give thanks to the Lord, for His love endures forever." We fight in worship. My weapon is a melody. My heart is praising God, and He goes before us, and that's the front lines of the battle. We also fight on our knees in intercessory prayer. Mark 9, verse 29, Jesus said to them, "This kind can come out by nothing but prayer," and some translations say, "and by fasting." We must fight on our knees. We must intercede. We must be people of prayer. And that is our spiritual training, and that is our spiritual weapon. We look at our text again in 2 Timothy chapter 2, the first four verses. "You therefore, my son, be strong in the grace that is in Christ Jesus." Be strong. "The things that you have heard from me among many witnesses, commit these to faithful men who will be able to teach others also." It is said that the function of armed forces is to recruit, to equip, to deploy, and engage. And he said, be faithful, to commit this to faithful men, and they will teach others also. It must pass on. We must pass on spiritual strength and not just trust in somebody, well, so-and-so, our pastor or an evangelist or some prayer warrior that I know, a Bible teacher, a Sunday school class teacher, somebody I know, they're strong in their faith, and we'll let them be the prayer warriors, and we'll let them intercede for us. Well, we need to learn to do that too and pass it on to each new generation that the connection with God in faith is the main connection. That's the power source. Therefore, endure hardship as a good soldier of Jesus Christ. No one engaged in warfare entangles himself with the affairs of this life that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. Our priority has to remain loyalty to the call of our commander-in-chief. And the other things of life, they're the support structure of the call that we have as soldiers of the cross. Now let's look at a familiar passage in Ephesians chapter 6, beginning at verse 10. "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in His mighty power." There you go. "Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God, that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to take stand and stand your ground. And after you've done everything, to stand. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith, with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people." That is the activity of spiritual armed forces. We take up these things, we become skilled as to how they fit our lives and how we use them for God's glory. If an army goes out without the right weaponry, they're doomed. If an army goes out with the right weaponry but never trained with them, doesn't know how to work with it, they're doomed. So spiritually, we must know the Word of God, we must be prayed up, we must be surrendered in our heart and our loyalty. God, whatever it takes, use me for your glory. Make a difference. Help me to make a difference in my life and in the lives around me and in our world. An interesting event in ancient Israel, we read about it in 1 Samuel chapter 14, when King Saul's son Jonathan and his armor bearer discovered an encampment of the Philistines. And there are many, many of them and just the two of them. Many Philistines and just the two of them. And in verse 6, Jonathan said to the young man who was carrying his armor, "Come, let us cross over to the garrison of these uncircumcised. Perhaps the Lord will work for us, for the Lord is not restrained to save by many or by few." It was two against apparently hundreds of thousands. I remember Evangelist Mario Murillo said, the armor bearer said to Jonathan, "What is our plan?" And Jonathan said, "We will surround them." You know what? We've got them surrounded. We really do. If we have God with us, we have the enemy surrounded. And we are the army of God, now and forever. We look in Revelation chapter 19, beginning at verse 11. "And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he who sat on it is called Faithful and True. And in righteousness he judges and wages war. His eyes are a flame of fire, and on his head are many diadems. And he has a name written on him which no one knows except himself. He is clothed with a robe dipped in blood, and his name is called the Word of God. His name is called the Word of God. And the armies which are in heaven, clothed in fine linen, white and clean, were following him on white horses." That's you and me forever and ever. And that white horse, the white linen, clean, has to do with purity. He has purified us, and on that basis, because we are of single focus, we love our Lord Jesus Christ. We belong to him. We belong in heaven. We're part of that, the armies of heaven, forever and ever, as we can rejoice in the mission done, mission accomplished, because we have the one who is victorious forever and ever. He will not fail. His kingdom will rule. His kingdom will reign in righteousness and justice and peace, putting down all things that are wrong. Thank you, Lord, for this time together. Lord, we thank you that you have called us to enter into your word and be enlisted in the kingdom of God. In the spiritual battles that you've called before us, and each one who hears these words has a different spiritual battle going on. If there's someone, the battle is that they're needing to surrender to you and receive forgiveness because of what you've done on the cross, then I pray that that battle will end. They'll surrender, Lord, and find that they were designed from before creation, that you made them to belong to you and to be in your kingdom. So, Lord, I pray that that battle will end. And then for every one of us, Lord, as we belong to your kingdom, you have called us to be faithful, good soldiers, and enduring whatever hardships are necessary so that we can please the one who's enlisted us. So we thank you, Lord, for this word today, for all the things your word has to say about the spiritual battle. And there are so many that have battles right now of various levels. But, Lord, may you encourage and strengthen and to help each one to know that as we turn it to you and let you lead on, we praise you, we live lives of prayer and intercession and rejoicing in you for who you are and what you do, that you draw us into victory right along with you. We thank you for it in Jesus' name. Amen.